This is a video on Sri Aurobindo's Life Divine, Chapter 15, Book 1, The Supreme Truth Consciousness, and Chapter 16, Book 1, The Triple Status of the Mind. Hello, this is Chris speaking, wake up with another video on Sri Aurobindo's Life Divine. The other day I was asked to continue the series on the Life Divine, so I'm continuing the series on the Life Divine. I have no agenda here. I will talk about whatever you would like me to talk about. We have seen in the last Life Divine video on chapter 14 that the supermind is available to you and in you, in each and every one of us, in all of creation, and that you don't have to look outside for it. It is not some kind of remote or inaccessible or uninvolved God or Goddess. It is here in you now, and you can access it. But the term mind in supermind is misleading. It is not some kind of advanced thinking apparatus. It is not like the mind only super somehow. It is a divine faculty which we can access because we are not separate from the divine. It is the Buddha in you, so to say, as the Buddhists say. The Buddha is there already, you just have to remember. And to be plugged into the supermind does not feel like thinking, it feels more like seeing. The Greeks called it intuitive knowledge. Scientia intuitiva in Latin, or gnosis in Greek. You just know instantly. You see clearly how things are without any interpretation of your mind and emotions and memories in between to distort it. You don't need anything for it, just the connection, and you can see objectively. This, of course, can easily and quickly become the perfect fodder for the ego. The ego can think, of course, or pretend that it is already in contact with the supermind. In fact, it will most probably try to claim this. But alas, no, it does not work. If you are identified with your personality, you cannot be in contact with the supermind. These two things cannot occur simultaneously. So, surrender has to come first. There is no way you can access the supermind while still thinking that you are your habits and your programs and your conditionings or thoughts or emotions. You are much more and also much less than that. You are an instrument, a servant of the divine consciousness, willing or no. Better willing, though. I have explained this in the 11th chapter, in the video on the 11th chapter of the Synthesis of Yoga, link is below, the master of our work. In the Karma Yoga part of Sri Aurobindo's Synthesis, and he explains the process of surrender in distinct steps, in proper order, in order to be able to receive higher faculties like the supermind. Now, in this 15th chapter, the Supreme Truth Consciousness, and the 16th chapter, the Triple Status of the Mind, which have to be read simultaneously, or first 15, 16, then again 15, 16. They belong together and they're difficult to understand without each other. Especially 15 actually is almost intelligible without having read 16. So my recommendation, read 15, 16, and then again 15, 16. So the 15th chapter is divided into two parts. The first part describes the power and clarity of the supermind and the truth consciousness, as the Vedic seers called it. He repeats a lot from the previous chapter, but in a slightly different light, and also introduces a new important term that is often used in very unclear ways today, the soul. We will come back to the soul in the next chapter, where he explains exactly what he means by this ominous word soul. He also mentions Purusha and Prakriti again. In a nutshell, Purusha is the part of the Absolute, which is pure awareness, and Prakriti is its complementary part of action. So consciousness and action, consciousness and force, are really one thing, as we have seen in chapter 10. And for the intuitive truth consciousness to be received, downloaded, seen, plugged into, whatever you want to call it, we need to connect to the Purusha. In philosophy, a distinction has been made between the knower, the known, the knowledge, and the act of knowing. But again, it is really all one and the same. Just as the enjoyer, the joy in the thing that is being enjoyed is all the same. When we talk about it, we like to explain it in separate terms, beings, actions, and so on. But really it is all one happening at once. The supermind is, like the divine, all-pervading. It is in every part of all of the creation, present all the time. And while the ego and its mental activities have forgotten that, the soul hasn't. The ego, however, must forget this, in fact, otherwise there is no play, no lila, nothing happening. If you want to remember, though, the first step is to realize that the consciousness and force of the universe enters you as a part of the whole. You're a part of the whole, so the consciousness and force enters you and exits you as well. It is streaming and flowing through you. You are not the origin of any consciousness or force, but it feels like it because you don't feel the flowing in. You don't feel it flowing in and out consciously, especially not the flowing into you. So you think it comes from you, but actually it flows into you and then out of you again. You are a concentration of this conscious force, but you do not generate it. I repeat, the conscious force does not originate in and from you. You are not its origin. It emanates from you, but only because it has flown into you beforehand. So it's flowing in and out. And the origin is the divine, not you as a person who dreams a dream of separation. Thus even Descartes' "I think, therefore I am" is not completely true and safe to say. It should be something like "I am aware, therefore there is an awareness of connection to the whole." The awareness feels to us like individuality, but it is not. If you plug your computer into the electrical power grid, it uses its electricity, but it does not generate it. Same with the internet. You can access the internet with your smartphone, for example, but the smartphone doesn't generate the internet. So you are not the origin of consciousness, but you can participate in it, although not with your intellect. The link is not your mind, but your soul. The soul is the connection. The ego is the separation. The personality is the separation. Only when you give up the identification and insistence on separation, you can feel the unity and download whatever it is necessary right now. Not whatever you want. It's not a buffet. It's not a buffet as the modern manifestation teachers preach. You cannot order the supermind to send you a $500,000 sports car because it is not necessary for the divine plan. And if it is necessary for the divine plan, then you will get the Lamborghini anyhow, if you want it or not. So, it's not a mail order thing. It's not like a cosmic Amazon.com. But it is there all the time. And once you dissolve the concentration of force that you truly are, even more consciousness and force can flow through you. But not according to your will. Rather, you will be a mindless vessel. I know that's hard to take, but it's always according to the divine will, not yours. Because who are you? Huh? Definitely not your personality. So think hard if you really, really want enlightenment, because you, as you know yourself now, will be gone when enlightenment happens to you. That's the first aspect of the supermind. The second aspect, or poise, as Sri Aurobindo calls it, this is described in chapter 16, the triple status of the supermind. The second poise is that the supermind is in everything, not just in its origin of oneness. It's not that it, once it leaves its origin of oneness, it's separate from itself. No. It's always in everything. Every little sand grain or air molecule is full of conscious force of the universe, because without it, it would not even exist. Everything that exists or seems to exist apparently is part of the conscious force of the universe, and thus the consciousness and force is also in it. But to maintain this wonderful creation, concentrations of this force are necessary. And these concentrations we call form and matter. Form and matter come into being, and also its individuality, and also the human delusion of a separate personality, separate person doing and deciding things. These few chapters are very important, because there's always this discussion in the spiritual marketplace: is the world an illusion or not? And Sri Aurobindo starts to answer this very, very big question in these two chapters. It is an illusion, it is not an illusion at the same time. And these three poises of the supramental, of the supermind, are why. So the third poise is an involvement in its creation. Supreme Truth Consciousness does not stand back and watch its own unfolding passively. So the first poise is oneness. The second poise is multiplicity and ignorance. The necessity of multiplicity and ignorance, otherwise there would be no creation. And the third poise is the connection between the first two, the liveliness in it, its involvement in its own play of differentiation and diversity. It loses itself in the dream of duality to some degree. Thus the ananda, the bliss, comes into play, literally. The bliss is the joy of enjoying the cosmic game of duality and multiplicity, knowing that there's only oneness, really, truly. It's like when you're watching a movie, part of you has to believe that this is happening right now, otherwise you can't enjoy the movie. If you watch a movie and you tell yourself all the time, oh, it's just a movie anyway, it's just fiction, you cannot enjoy it fully. Well, if you let yourself being absorbed by the movie, and by the emotions and by identification with the characters and so on, then you can fully enjoy it. So you have to lose your consciousness to some degree in the play. But since the play is also part of you, if you're the divine absolute, nothing can really happen. You cannot lose yourself in yourself fully. So the way to achieve this partial forgetting, so that this game, this play of consciousness can unfold, is time. Time obscures the eternal oneness, the now, and helps to create the ignorance of separation. It creates a storyline that can be believed, is believable, and even convincing. Conversely, if we concentrate on the true unity of the timeless oneness, we can observe the play of the divine unity in the apparent many. This sounds a lot like Shivapuri Baba and Tony Parsons, if you ask me, and why not? They're all talking about the same thing. This is one of the deepest truths, and it cannot be understood by the dual mind, unfortunately. Cannot be understood by the mind, but it can be directly perceived, seen by the supermind in us. The absolute is absolute, and thus not limited by our inbuilt limitations. So you can either insist that what our limited mind thinks must be true, or at least nothing more can be known, or you can surrender to the fact that you are only a tiny aspect of the divine unity, and the multiplicity and most other ideas are only illusions to make the divine play possible. The infinite is absolutely free. We are not, because we are fully in the play. The divine has created the play and is part of it, but is also aware of it. But we have lost the awareness that we are part of the play. That's why it is, from a higher perspective, it's all illusion. But if you're in it, it's not all illusion. Until we surrender to the absolute and let it guide and show us what is what, through internal seeing, we will be fully absorbed in and by this play. And if we are fully absorbed, for us it is not an illusion, it's reality. And this is possible because of the paradoxon that you are not God, but at the same time you are not separate from the divine either. Nothing can be other than the divine, because all is the divine absolute. And each and every part has also a degree of divine self-knowledge, or at least the potential link to it, like an unplugged electricity or internet connection. It is there. It is just not connected, but it could be connected and can be connected any time. And the key is time. Time's the key here. It is simultaneously the blinding veil that stops us from seeing what is real, and also the keyhole of the door out of the illusion. Every moment is, like Tony Parsons and Eckhart Tolle do not tire to explain, replaced by another, slightly modified, and thus the illusion of succession of moments, of cause and effect, of linear time is created and maintained. So from a higher vantage point, nothing is really happening. It's just one moment being replaced by another, which is almost the same. It is more of a recurrence, really. And Sri Aurobindo calls them strains instead of moments or locations. They are potentialities of space-time. The replacement of one such strain with the next is a shock to us. So the memory of now is constantly being deleted every time such a shock of replacement hits us, and we perceive the whole thing as an harmonious, uninterrupted linear flow of time. Like a movie or like a flipbook. Do you remember these children's flipbooks that you operate with your thumb? Our brain is tricked by the quick succession of more than 24 similar pictures and creates the illusion of a live motion because the alternative is too exhausting. This is also how animated movies are made, and actually all movies. You can adjust the speed of the succession of pictures. Sri Aurobindo writes, "To see things steadily and see them whole is not possible to the mind, but it is the very nature of the transcendent supermind. The supermind, in its conscious vision, not only contains all the forms of itself, which its conscious force creates, but it pervades them as an indwelling presence and self-revealing light. It is present, even though concealed, in every form and force of the universe. Meaning, the truth is concealed on the one hand, and also omnipresent on the other hand. Both actions, concealment and revelation, are happening each and every moment in each and every space and being simultaneously, and thus can be accessed by each and every aspect of creation anytime. More so, since there is really only now. We have access to the supermind if we like to and if we let it. And thus, we can see the unveiled truth if we surrender to our smallness first. Our divine potential can be made visible by giving up our divinity first, giving up control. Thank you for listening, thank you for watching, thank you for subscribing and joining me on Facebook or Patreon. And see you soon with the 17th chapter of The Life Divine, The Divine Soul.